Hello and welcome to the FCCJ. My name is Daniel Hurst. I'm a freelance journalist and I'll be your moderator today. Before we start, can I just ask everyone to make sure that your phone is either switched off or on silent mode? The use of physical restraints in hospitals in Japan has come under scrutiny after the tragic death of Kelly Savage in May. Kelly, a dual national of New Zealand and the US, came to Japan to teach English under the JET program. He was admitted to Yamato Hospital, a psychiatric hospital in Kanagawa Prefecture, on April the 30th after a manic episode. He suffered a heart attack after being restrained, sadly, for 10 days. The hospital is yet to comment on the case. Today we'll be hearing from Professor Toshio Hasegawa, who will speak about the wider trends in the Japanese health system, and we'll also be hearing from Kelly's mother, Dr. Martha Savage, and brother, Patrick Savage. And today's consecutive interpretation will be provided by Ms. Sakaya Gloria Kato. Please welcome our guests. Professor.
長谷川俊夫と申します。本日は精神科医療の身体拘束を考える会の設立記者会見にお集まりいただき大変ありがとうございます。私は東京にあります京林大学の教授をしております。皆さんは身体拘束というものをご存知でしょうか。
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Toshio Hasegawa. I'm a professor of Kyorin University in Tokyo. And thank you very much indeed for joining our launch and announce of the Alliance Against Physical Restraint. And do you know, by the way, what it is it all about, the physical restraint?
これが身体を拘束するものです。胴体に巻いてここにマグネットをつけて、でこれがベッドにつけられると。そうするともうこれで完全にベッドに固定されるわけですけども、これがこの私が受けている写真ですが、これがお腹の部分がこれです。
ちょっとここで止まりましょうか。 And by the way, you know, this is the physical restraint, the device itself in a belt and strap, as you can see. And once you, this strap is applied to your waist, and this has got the magnet at the end, and it's going to be tied to your bed. Now, this is me in the physical restraint. And you see, I am not able to move at all with this physical restraint.
で両手と両足首も、ベッドにつながれています。
And you can see arms, wrists and the legs. They are completely tied to the bed frames.
でさらに、この肩の部分もする肩ベルトというものもあるとこうをつけるとこうなります。
And there's another strap called the shoulder belt. And if you attach the shoulder belt, you'll be in this shape. I am here.
この肩ベルトもしてしまうと、一生懸命こうやって起き上がろうとしても、起き上がることは全くできません。
You really cannot rise because, if you put the shoulders tied to the belt, you really cannot, go up.
とても、苦しい状態になります。人権上も大きな問題があります。
And as you can imagine, you will be in such a difficult position and you feel such a stress and it's really a distress. And in terms of the human rights, it poses a huge issue.
で日本の精神科病院には29万人の人たちが入院しています。
And in Japan, in the psychiatric ward of the Japanese psychiatric hospitals, we have got approximately 290,000 patients that are hospitalized.
そのうち20万人以上が1年以上入院しています。驚きませんか？
And you would be surprised to hear that of the 290,000 patients, 200,000 patients are hospitalized more than 1 year.
日本全体の、病院の病床数は150万床です。つまり日本全国の病床の5つに1つは精神科のベッドになっています。
In Japan, by the way, all across Japan, we have got 1.5 million beds across Japan. Of the 1.5 million, 1 in 5 beds are for psychiatric hospitals.
1960年代に欧米では病院中心の精神医療から地域中心の精神医療に変えていったときに、日本は逆に精神病床を増やしていったのです。
In the 1960s, in Europe and the United States, the treatment for the psychiatric patients actually changed from the hospital centered to the regional centered treatment and therapies. However, Japan actually took the completely the reverse course.That means that the psychiatric beds and hospitals were increased.
その結果、2017年現在も1000を超える精神科病院に多くの長期入院患者がいます。
And as a result, as of today, in the year 2017, more than 1,000 psychiatric hospitals are here in Japan, and lots of psychiatric patients are hospitalized there.
つまり日本の精神科医療は未だ隔離収容政策から脱していないのです。
Means that the Japanese psychiatric medicine has never been out of the scope of isolation.
しかも精神科病院に入院する人の平均在日数は約280日です。
And on average, 280 days are spent by those patients in the psychiatric ward.
日本においてはこのような異常な精神医療の状況下で隔離や身体拘束が多く用いられています。
Isolation as well as physical restraints are performed and applied to the patients under such an abnormal situation。
先ほど日本には29万人、つまり約30万人の人が精神科に入院していると言いましたが、国の最新のデータではこのうち隔離をされている人が1万人、身体拘束を受けている人が1万人いることが分かっています。2万人の人が隔離や身体拘束を受けているのです。
As I mentioned earlier, roughly 290,000 patients, psychiatric patients are there, and in the round number, it's approximately 300,000 patients in the psychiatric wards. And in according to our latest data, among those 300,000 patients, 10,000patients are isolated in a closed ward, whereas the 10,000 patients are under physical restraints.
今記者会見をしているこの瞬間も、
As of this moment, they are under the situation.
精神科病院の中で身体拘束を受ける人の数はここ10年で2倍になりました。
As a matter of fact, the physical restraints are applied to the psychiatric patients, and the number has become doubled in the past decade.
この赤い線が身体拘束の人数を表しています。
You can see the red line indicates the patient numbers applied with the physical restraints.
2004年に5242人だった身体拘束をされている人の数。
You can see back in the year 2004, 5242 patients were under physical restraints.
2014年には10,000飛び682人が身体拘束を受けています。
And now, in 2014, 10,682 patients are under physical restraints.
私は、精神科医療の身体拘束をテーマに2010年に論文を書き、博士の学位を取得しました。
I actually wrote a thesis upon the physical restraint applied to the psychiatric patients back in the year 2010, and I got the PhD degree with that.
で2013年に急増しつつある身体拘束に警鐘を鳴らす意味も込めて、こちらの精神科医療の隔離身体拘束という本を上申しました。
And back in the year 2013, I actually issued this particular book in order to send alarm to the society with regard to this concern physical restraint.
その後、精神科医療での隔離や身体拘束の急増問題について、さまざまなところで講演をするなどして、縮減を訴えてきました。
And later on, I have been telling people that we should reduce the number of physical restraints or isolation currently practiced in the psychiatric ward in Japanese medicines.
しかし、縮減どころか、隔離も身体拘束も異常な増加を続けています。
But at an alarming and abnormal rate, the isolation, physical restraints are increasing.
サベジさんご一家、それから今日そちらにいらっしゃっている日本人の、ご遺族の方もいらっしゃいますが、その、ご一家に起こってしまったことは、このような日本の精神医療の状況下、起こるべくして起きたのです。
And the tragedy suffered by the, Kerry Savage and his believed family, as well as one another Japanese family, that's actually caused under such an abnormal situation, in the Japanese psychiatric medicine.
主催者を代表して2つのお願いがあります。
There are two requests, as a representative of this alliance.
一つはどうかサベジさん、そしてそちらにいらっしゃる息子さんを亡くされたあの女性の、まあ、千葉さんに起こった悲劇に対して、また無念にも亡くなっていたサベジさんのご子息、千葉さんご子息、その残された遺族に対してどうか心を寄せてください。
The first question, request is, please, for Mr. Savage, Mr. Kerry Savage and his believed family, as well as for the, Mr. Chiba and his believed family, the, who, actually, they, those sons, actually, they passed away, and regretfully they, passed away. So please send good thoughts for them.
そしてもう一つは、どうかこの悲劇をスキャンダラスな事件ということでなく、社会におけるさまざまな構造的な問題によって引き起こされていることを理解していただき、その解決に向けて共に考えてほしいのです。
And we would like you to understand and think together with us, why this kind of, tragedy is caused and under what kind of structure this kind of tragedy is actually caused.By not treating this kind of incident as a scandal, a scandalous accident, this is a tragedy.
私たちが精神科医療の身体拘束を考える会を立ち上げるのは、まさに日本の精神医療の問題を市民、国民とともに考え、解決していくためなのです。
The very reason and the intent of launching, this new alliance, Alliance Against Physical Restraint in Psychiatric Hospital, is as follows. We need to, think about the, psychiatric medicine and the associated issues here in Japan and in Japanese society, and we would like to find the solutions for them.
会の方針は以下の通りです。
Alliance policy is as follows.
私たちは身体拘束が人の尊厳を傷つけ、命まで奪いかねない非人道的なものであるか、あるという、そういう共通の認識を持つこと。
We would like to share the common views and the recognitions upon the physical restraints that would impair the dignity of people and that could also, that could also take the lives of the people and they could be inhuman.
身体拘束によって苦しめられた方々からの話を多く収集し、その実態を社会に知らせること。
Now, we would like to collect the information of the people who might have suffered the physical restraints, and we would like to disclose the facts into the society.
身体拘束の実施過程の可視化など、身体拘束が適切に行われているか、事後に検証できるシステムの構築を目指すこと。
There, we would like to, visualize how and when and why the physical restraints are applied. And we'd like to visualize the application and the determination assessment process of the physical restraints. And that we would like to also build up a system, to verify the application of the physical restraintsAnd we'd like to also, check if, they are appropriately done or not afterwards.
不必要な身体拘束をなくし、その実施を縮減していくことを目指し、広範な市民と連携していくこと。
Now we would like to eliminate unruly and unnecessary physical restraints, and, we'd like to, minimize or zero down them, together joining hands with the citizens, broadly here in Japan.
会を立ち上げ、今この瞬間も日本の精神科病院の中で行われている隔離や身体拘束を減らし、悲劇を繰り返さないためには、今日お集まりの第一線のメディアの方々のこの問題への深い理解が欠かせません。
Yeah. We are currently launching the new alliance like this. And at this particular moment, you know, a lot of patients are suffering in the Japanese psychiatric hospitals and the isolated wards, where we'd like to reduce the number of physical restraints applications as much as possible, so as not to repeat the tragedies suffered by the families here today. And we would like you to understand the issues seriously and deeply together with the media representatives here today.
私たちはその理解を進めていくために力を尽くすことに、尽くすことに惜しみません。
We wouldn't spare any sorts of efforts in order to deepen the understanding in the society on this issue.
どうか今日を機に末永くお付き合いいただけることを心から願っています。
And I would like you to go with us and continuously support us taking this very precious opportunity. Thank you very much.
私の方からは、以上ですので、マーサさんの方からお話をしたいと思います。
Now, and there, that's all from me. And then now I'd like to pass on to Ms. Martha Savage, who is the mother of the past, Kelly Savage.
Thank you. Yes, I'm Kelly Savage's mother. I'm a seismologist. I work at Victoria University of Wellington and professor of geophysics.I study earthquakes. And I'm 60 years old. So just wanted to tell you about my son. Kelly was a wonderful son. He packed a lot of good times into his short life. As a child, he was incredibly active and would rather play than eat. Even when he was a baby, he would only nurse for a few minutes at a time and then pull away so he could watch what was going on around him.He started walking at 10 months and soon was running all over the place. He liked to throw rocks into the ditch behind our house and jump on our trampoline. He was always on the move. An avid cricket and basketball player and fan, Kelly continued to enjoy life most when playing sports or games. He particularly liked board games, both as a child with Monopoly and Cluedo, and as a young adult with Settlers of Catan and similar games.Kelly also loved all things Japanese. From the time his older brother first brought a Japanese exchange student home, through his own study in high school and university, he was fascinated with the language, the culture, the food, the cities, and the mountains. When Kelly was in his last year in high school, I didn't want to talk about that. So he went on and then he became an exchange student at Wakayama High School in Japan after high school. Kelly loved people. His friends and acquaintances said he put them at ease and laughed a lot. Even in some of his most depressed times, being around people seemed to help Kelly to pull out of his negative thoughts and be happy for a while.Some of his friends have put together a YouTube video that's up on the internet about their happy times together. You can see that. Kelly was especially concerned about helping his friends and fulfilling commitments to them. He seemed to constantly be picking up or dropping people off at the Wellington Airport, often people going to or coming from Japan. He was also very attached to family. In spite of some normal sibling rivalry,Kelly adored his older brother and tried to emulate him. He came to family reunions almost every year to see his grandparents, aunts and uncles and cousins in the US. And in the last 3 years, he especially loved playing with his niece. We were also really pleased that he was able to meet his 2-month-old nephew before he died. Kelly had several years of struggle through university, including bouts of major depression and a 1-month stint in a hospital.For a psychotic episode. Now, during that episode for 1 month, he was never restrained they never ever used restraints, and they just don't use physical restraints in New Zealand. He did have a short period of a few hours in a room that was a low stimulation room, they called it. But in university, he enjoyed learning Japanese and psychology, and when he was in a good mood,He would talk about his classes. I especially remember his discussion of the rats in his psychology lab and his interest in how they learned. Even though He sometimes had trouble keeping up with his assignments when he was depressed. Kelly was determined to finish his degree so that he could reach his major goal of being an English teacher in Japan. He was ecstatic when he learned of his acceptance into the JET program, and he had nearly 2 years of success in it. He loved living in Japan and found that he also enjoyed the small city of Shibushi where he lived and taught. But most of all, he loved teaching the children, and they all loved him. Last year, I was on a research and study leave from October through January in Japan. The highlight of my trip was a long weekend we took down to Shibushi to see Kelly. It was so great to see him doing well and settled into his community. We met his friends, and he showed us his favorite places and onsens. But the best part for me was the day that we went with him to school. He showed us his teachers and the children, and we went to one of the 8 schools that he taught in. We were so pleased to see how happy he was and how much he loved his work. He planned fun lessons with the children about Halloween, and they learned through games, and it was clear that the children loved him. In fact, they made this beautiful card for him for the end of the year last year, and they wrote wonderful letters about how much they liked him. And you're not supposed to show the faces of the kids, but you can see the cards. They just wrote nice things. Unfortunately, in late April, Kelly's psychiatric symptoms came back, and he was admitted to hospital here in Japan, which ultimately led to cardiac arrest and death. His brother is going to tell you details about that. After his passing, the children at schools wrote wonderful notes and letters and telling Kelly how much they loved him and missed him, and they hoped that he would be happy in heaven. They all said that they loved his fun classes and wanted to work hard in English even more to honor him. So we don't want this tragedy to happen to anybody else, and so the main thing we want, we're not going to try to, well, we don't think we'll try to sue the hospital. We just really want to stop this from happening to anybody else. So we want Japan to change the way that they treat psychiatric patients. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll now hear from Mr. Patrick Savage, who's the brother.
I'm Kelly's brother, Patrick. I'm 32 years old. Kelly was 27 years old when he died. So this is a picture of me and Kelly. My brother Kelly painted Easter eggs when he was about 13. And Kelly was my only brother and my best friend. His death has been an incredible tragedy for our whole family and all of his friends. But since I'm the one who was there at the time he was restrained, and of all the evidence of his mistreatment by Yamato Hospital, I'm going to focus just on the objective evidence I have of this incident and not of his life in general. So in March this year, Kelly stopped taking his medication, and in April he started feeling bad. On April 25th, he flew up to my apartment in Yokohama to be in a safe place for a week or two so he could get back on his medication. I'm glad he at least got the chance to meet his newborn nephew before he died. Unfortunately, although he restarted his medication, his symptoms just got worse, and on the evening of April 29th and the morning of the 30th, he seemed to lose touch with reality. He screamed, ran outside, and pushed my dad when he tried to stop him from leaving. I first called an ambulance, but was told they couldn't help with mental health. I finally called the police on the morning of the 30th to put them on standby, but they decided to come immediately. When they tried to escort Kelly, he struggled and tried to escape. And so they restrained and handcuffed him. Once he was handcuffed, he calmed down and walked to the police car, escorted by the police. After a few hours, Yokohama City office arranged for us to be taken to Yamato Hospital for an interview for compulsory hospitalization. Kelly didn't struggle, but he refused to respond to the interview. At 2:58 p.m., his compulsory hospitalization was authorized by Yokohama Mayor Hayashi. We were immediately taken to a locked room in a locked ward where Kelly was ordered to lie down on the bed. I should add, the interview was conducted by 2 doctors, one from the Yokohama City office, and the other was the head of Yamato Hospital, Dr. Ishii. So after the authorization, we were immediately taken to a locked room in a locked ward where Kelly was ordered to lie down on the bed. He complied, but nevertheless, at 3:10 p.m., they used restraints to tie his legs, waist, and wrists to the bed. This is confirmed by his doctor's records, which state that restraints were begun on April 30th at 3:10 p.m. due to a possibility that he might become agitated, but say nothing about him being agitated at the time of restraint. There's no further mention of restraints being removed in his doctor's records until his cardiac arrest on May 30th. So I was there at the time, and then next I was taken away from his room, and I was ordered by Nurse Akagi to pay for a pajama set with diapers because Kelly would be restrained and unable to use the toilet for a long time. This is a picture I took of the form they had me fill out, the E-set as the diaper set. It's very much part of the hospital policy. And then according to a meeting I recorded with his doctors, the wrist restraints were sometimes removed, but the leg and waist restraints were never removed except very briefly to clean Kelly's body or move him from room to room. This is a photo of Kelly lying on his hospital bed that I took on May 8th, and this is a photo of the scars on his ankles that were left by the restraints that my mom took the day before he died. At 9:25 p.m. on May 10th, a nurse found Kelly in a state of cardiac arrest. His heart stopped for almost an hour. It was finally restarted after he was transported by ambulance to an ICU at the nearby Yamato Municipal Hospital, different from Yamato Hospital, which was a psychiatric hospital that he was initially hospitalized at. So he was hospitalized at Yamato Byoin, and then he was transported after the cardiac arrest to Yamato Shiritsu Byoin. Unfortunately, it was too late. Kelly was in a coma on a respirator, unable to breathe by himself. A CAT scan was taken on May 15th and confirmed that Kelly's brain was irreversibly damaged and he would never regain consciousness. 2 days later, his heart stopped beating for good. On May 14th, Kelly's cardiologist wrote that he suspected Kelly's cardiac arrest was caused by deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism. This is when a blood clot develops in the legs due to lack of movement and then travels through the bloodstream to block the lung. The suspicion was based on the readings from Kelly's blood pressure, oxygen levels, and blood tests, combined with the fact that Kelly's primary psychiatrist at Yamato Hospital had told the cardiologist over the phone that Kelly had been restrained continuously for 10 days. This was the first time this possibility had ever occurred to any of my family, and we couldn't stop crying when we heard this news. We thought the restraints were inhumane and unnecessary in Kelly's case, but we had no idea they could have caused Kelly's cardiac arrest. When we looked, however, it turned out that the risk was well known. So this article published in 2014, based on data from Japanese psychiatric hospitals, shows that almost 1 in 5 psychiatric patients restrained for more than 3 days develops deep vein thrombosis, so 19%. We had hoped that we could get some kind of closure, one way or the other, from the autopsy, but it was inconclusive, although it ruled out the possibility of a pre-existing heart condition. Although the autopsy couldn't find a blood clot, Kelly's cardiologist explained to us that often when a blood clot is relatively new, it can be hard to differentiate it from regular blood that is simply hardened after death. In the end, he said that he still suspected either deep vein thrombosis or possibly side effects of psychiatric medications. But without a conclusive autopsy, he said we would probably never know for sure. At this point, we began trying to get answers from Yamato Hospital, or the MedSafe system, which is the Nihon Iryo Anzen Chousa Kiko, which is supposed to investigate this type of medical accident. However, Yamato Hospital has completely stonewalled us and refused to report itself for the investigation or give us copies of Kelly's medical records. Unfortunately, there's a well-known problem with the MedSafe system, which is that it doesn't have any power to independently investigate unless the hospital voluntarily reports itself for investigation. And of course, they don't want to do that. In our case, the director of the hospital, who's the same doctor who authorized Kelly's hospitalization and then restraint in the first place, responded to our requests with this letter here, stating that the hospital couldn't imagine any possibility that Kelly's death could be related to the treatment. However, this is directly contradicted by an admission made by one of Kelly's supervising psychiatrists who admitted on tape that deep vein thrombosis was a possible cause. Other than allowing me to view a subset of Kelly's records for 1 hour on July 12th, Yamato Hospital has continued to refuse to release Kelly's medical records or allow us to copy them, despite being obligated to do so. I began requesting these over the phone on May 31st, and finally had a lawyer send our lawyer, Mr. Sasaki, send them a letter, a formal request on July 7th after it became clear that they had no intention of letting us ever access these copies. Yamato Hospital has yet to provide a definitive answer to this request from 2 weeks ago. The New Zealand Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade is inquiring with the Japanese government on our behalf about why these records are being denied. Finally, just yesterday, I discovered proof that Yamato Hospital has been falsifying Kelly's medical records. During the meeting I recorded on July 12th, I became suspicious because it listed giving Kelly a blood test at 14:08 to check for indications of any pre-existing blood clots. However, I was with Kelly at his compulsory hospitalization interview, after which he was immediately restrained at 3:10 p.m., and I never saw them administer any blood tests. So yesterday I called the Yokohama City office to check the official time of his compulsory hospitalization authorization, and as I suspected, it was 14:58. It was 50 minutes. So 50 minutes after the time that they claimed to have already been performing medical tests on him. And I also recorded this phone call. So they still won't give me documents of either of these things, but I have audio recordings confirming these times from the visual viewing of his medical records at Yamato Hospital and from my phone call to Yamato City office. Unfortunately, what happened to Kelly is only the tip of the iceberg. The only reason it's finally getting any media attention is because Kelly was from New Zealand and his death was on the front page of the largest newspaper in New Zealand, the New Zealand Herald here. So several major Japanese papers that have now interviewed me never responded when I first called over a month ago to tell them this news. Although Kelly's restraint of 10 days was hundreds of times longer than most developed countries, it wasn't even close to the average restraint time that Professor Hasegawa has already told you of 96 days. So I'm sure there must be many more families out there that have been through the same horrible experience but didn't or couldn't manage to get anyone to care. God knows it's been hard enough for my family, and many times we've wondered whether we should just give up. But the thought that if we did, other families would continue having to sacrifice their loved ones to Japan's broken psychiatric system was just too much to bear. How can the country that's hosting the 2020 Olympics and Paralympics claim to represent equality for all humans when it's violating UN policies regarding the human rights of mentally ill patients on a massive scale? The world needs to know what's happening, and Japan needs to act immediately to stop it. Please, don't let what happened to my brother happen to anyone else ever again. Thank you.
Thank you all for your sharing that with us. We're going to turn the floor over to questions now. So please try and keep your questions brief, one question only, as we're running low on time. So first questions are from the press. Anyone who wants to ask a question?
Hi, Sophie Jackman from Kyoto News World Service. Thank you for holding the press conference today. I'd like to ask if you know who in the Japanese government would be responsible for bringing about this change, and have you made an appeal to them, and do you plan to? What steps will you take next? Thank you.
Do you want to answer? Well, we are writing a petition now. Pat just put it up on change.org.
So technically, Professor Hasegawa is the association that he's formed. We all drafted together a petition, and he just launched it, and it's just gone live a couple hours ago. So it's a petition addressed to Prime Minister Abe and to the Minister of Health and Labor and Welfare, asking them to change the system.
Okay, next question. If there's no takers for questions, I might ask. Please come up.
This is probably for Professor Hasegawa. I'm from the BBC, sorry. I just looked on Google to look at some comparisons and the statistics around the world. For example, in Britain, in 1 year, 39,000 people were restrained. In Canada, 1 in 4 psychiatric patients are restrained, but it doesn't say for how long. So how different is the use of restraints in Japan compared to the use in other countries around the world? Because it seems like this is still a very common practice not just in Japan, but all around the world. Thank you.
日本の精神科病院には今29万人の人が入院しています。
As I mentioned, approximately 290,000 patients are hospitalized in the psychiatric ward.
で、そのうち、身体拘束を受けている人が1万人。
And of that 290,000 patients, 10,000 patients are under physical restraints.
隔離をされている人も1万人。
And there are 10,000 out of 290,000 patients are isolated.
で、ですから2万人の人が隔離か身体拘束をされている。
Means that, in total, approximately 20,000 patients are either isolated or under physical restraints.
で、そうすると入院患者のうちの、約 7% が、隔離または身体拘束をされていることになります。
精神科病棟の、
ああ、そうですね。
So, that means approximately 7% of the psychiatric patients are either isolated or under physical restraint.
基本的に、どれぐらいのパーセントの人が、されているっていうよりも、実際されている人がどれぐらいの期間されていることの方が大きい問題のように思います。
I guess the major issue is not the percentage or proportion of the patients, but the how long they are under physical restraints. That's the more important and the serious issue, I guess.
大事なことは、仮に一旦身体拘束を受けるようなことがあったとしても、解除に向けて真剣な話し合いが行われて早めに解放されることです。
What is important is even if one patient is actually under the physical restraint, what is important is the physician.And their patient and their family, they need to start discussing on how to remove the physical restraint in the earliest possible timing. That is the most important process we need to have.
論文によると、日本以外の国では、身体拘束については数時間から数十時間というのが、まあ平均です。
Now, according to the publications I read, in the other countries than Japan, the average physical restraint duration is a couple of hours, up to several 10 hours.
日本においては96日が平均、私の調査によれば。
Whereas according to my investigation, the physical restraintAverage duration is 96 days in Japan.
おそらくは漫然と行われているというふうに想像されます。
So, unconsciously, people are practicing the physical restraints here in Japan. That's all.
Yes, please.
I'm Pauline Reich. I'm an American lawyer and recently retired from being a professor at Waseda University School of Law, and I'm a writer. In the United States, with the advent of psychotropic medication, we've seen the emptying of institutions, and the medications have helped a lot of patients.I'm wondering, perhaps Dr. Hasegawa could tell me, if Japan is up to date on the psychiatric medications in use. I observed one case, it was my landlord's daughter who was being treated in a hospital in Tokyo. She was a teenager. She ultimately committed suicide. And I just wonder how successful psychiatric care is in Japan and whether the medications are the most up-to-date medications.
一般的に言えば、日本は多剤併用というふうに言われています。
Generally speaking, the psychiatric medicine and especially the medications, several medications are combined in the psychiatric treatment.
ですからできるだけ本当はできるだけ、よく効く薬を少量飲むということが望ましいと思います。
And the best case is to administer the patients with the high potent and highly efficacious drugs as at the minimum dose, and that should be the case. However,
ところが実際は何種類か の薬が、併用されていたりとか、あとその睡眠薬みたいなものが非常に多く用いられたりしています。
But the reality is that the number of drugs are combined and they are administered to the patients as a concomitant use, and usually and pretty commonly the again also the sleeping tablets are administered along with those several medications。
良くないケースとしては、その薬の副作用でふらつくから、身体拘束をするということもあるというふうに聞いています。
And in some worst case scenarios, some of the psychiatric patients and the mental illness patients, they had to be under physical restraints just because of too many medication that caused them feel really much weak.
あともう一つ重要なことは、身体拘束といったときに、おそらく英米圏ではフィジカルレストレイントとあとメディカルレストレイントって両方あると思います。
And probably in Europe and the United States there should be the clear separation between the physical restraint and the medical restraint。
日本の場合は身体拘束というとフィジカルの方だけで語られる文脈が多いです。
And in Japanese medical context, we only talk about the physical restraint.
ですから実際は非常に大量の薬を投与して、その暴れないようにするとかそういうことが多く行われていると思います。
And therefore, what is happening actually in the medical practice is you administer a lot of drugs to the patients in order to suppress their agitation.
以上です。
That's all.
Next question. Yes.
Hello, my name is James Ryan. I live in Japan. I'm an American citizen. My wife is Japanese. Number one, I'd like to say how impressed I am by your embassy and your ambassador as they stood by you, and also for the New Zealand press who covered your story. I think that is amazing. It's like a miracle in Japan.Okay. My son Jimmy, he suffered three severe medical mistakes, two deliberate, in Japan. He was given a death penalty drug at 5 months old, and he had caused severe brain damage, and then,He was suffocated with a plastic bag and strangled in Japan Boe Daigaku Byouin. Then we are trying to get protection from the United States Embassy that refused to intervene or give us transparency. Then my son was being deliberately starved till his bones popped out of his body. We've been maliciously denied all access to the media, and the courts actually were corrupted andtargeted my family. This is the only time I have been allowed access to the media. I've repeatedly pleaded for the Foreign Correspondents Club for life-saving transparency. They maliciously denied me too. I got my papers over there. I got everything, all the irrefutable evidence on YouTube, and on web pages. All I'm asking for is I'm pleading with you to please give my American boy transparency before he dies.
So do you have a, would you mind asking a
question? I just want to say thank you for bringing transparency. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you.
I might ask one question to the professor. You published your findings, I think you said, in 2010. What reaction did you have after publishing those findings? Did anything change? Did the government give any offers, or did the health ministry make any offers of looking into the matter? I'm interested to know whether there have been even suggestions of reform.
Thank you. I found no reaction against my publication in the year 2010. And honestly speaking, in the medical practice and also Japanese medical society, it is very rare to investigate and research on the physical constraints or his physical restraints.
ちょっと詳しくは申し上げられないですけども、研究を続けるのが非常に困難になった時期がありました。
Although I cannot elaborate in details, I had hard times when I really couldn't continue my research on the physical restraints.
で、私は法的な手段に出て、今研究を続けている立場を確保しています。
And I actually resorted to the litigation, and that's the reason why I am able to continue my research on the physical restraint.
で、ただ、国会とか国会議員に対しての働きかけをずっとやってきました。
I've been working and appealing to the Diet members since then.
論文を書いたのが2010年で、この本を出したのが2013年。
And I wrote my thesis back in the year 2010, and my book was issued in 2014.
で、今年、2017年に、ようやく日本の国会の、参議院の本会議で、身体拘束の急増の問題が、初めて取り上げられました。
これ何月ですか？
5月ですかね。
In May this year, in 2017, for the first time, the upper house took this matter in, and for the first time, they had the discussion on physical restraint issue.
でも多分こういう研究をやって国に対して厳しいことを言うのは国は非常に嫌がっていると思います。
But the government hates us to discuss on this matter and even the research on this matter.
まあこういう問題を追及するっていうことはいろんな利権を崩すことにつながるからです。
Because if I dig into this issue, the quite a lot of vested interests would be hampered.
以上
That's all for me.
Thank you. Questions? We'll start with you.
CNN の若月と申します。サビさんのご家族にまずお悔やみを申し上げたいと思います。一つ、ご質問したいのは、今回のケリーさんの死というのはですね、身体拘束の治療身体拘束のせいなのか、それとも大和病院が何かその身体拘束をしているという、治療の中で誤った行為をしたその結果なのか、どういうふうにその辺をお考えになっているのか教えてください。これはご家族でも構いませんし、長谷川教授でも構いません。
Or is that because of the physical restraint?
Well, we don't have proof of anything. The autopsy was inconclusive, so the doctors at the good hospital, the cardiologist wouldn't say one way or the other which one it was. We think that he seemed to think when he said he would speculate that it was DVT, and other people we've talked to said that's the very common thing. Deep vein thrombosis with a pulmonary embolism is very common to happen with this kind of restraints. I don't think that they were mistreated. I mean, the fact that they put restraints on was a mistreatment in my mind, but I don't think that they did anything else. I guess they didn't do some of the things they could have done to keep the restraints from causing deep vein thrombosis. They didn't do massaging of the legs. They didn't do any tests. They did the one test, the D-dimer test, or at least maybe they did it. They said they did it before they put the restraints on, and they never did another one to monitor him. And they didn't monitor whether he had DVT. But nobody, you know, nobody was... his nurses and doctors seemed to be trying to do the right thing. They weren't, nobody was being, you know, evil in terms of trying to, you know, torture him or anything, but beyond the torture of being in a restraint. So
I think the scary thing about it is that it wasn't like they were a bad hospital. It's just, it seems like this is just what happens throughout Japan, just the way things are. And I'm sure this happens to a lot more people that just never come forward. And for us, I think, you know, it's whether or not the cause was deep vein thrombosis or not, once we realized how widespread this practice was and how dangerous it is, we just were horrified that it was happening. And we, you know, it doesn't matter whether we can prove that it causes death in this particular case. It's undoubtedly it's well known to be a risk factor in deaths, and it there's no reason it should be happening today in Japan in 2017.
We have time for just a couple more questions. I'll come to you next.
So if I can ask Martha and Patrick. Firstly, did you had access to your brother? I mean, you saw your brother in hospital during that period. Did you remonstrate with the doctors? Did you request that they release the restraints, at least temporarily, and what was their response? And secondly, Martha, I mean, presumably you've been through episodes with your son before in New Zealand or elsewhere. How different did you see the treatment here compared to what you saw in treatment elsewhere?
Answer first, then you go.
Yeah.
So my mom actually didn't, she wasn't there at the time. She was booked a flight to come see him in the hospital, and the cardiac arrest occurred just before she was getting on her flight, so she didn't know what happened until she arrived and we met her at the airport and told her that Kelly was in a coma. But I was there, you know, on the day it happened. On the 30th, they let me come in on the 2nd to meet his doctor and see him. They wouldn't let me come in for the next week because it was Golden Week and his doctor was away. But I was calling every day, asking how he was doing, asking if they could remove the restraints yet, and they always said no, he's going to be restrained for a while longer. The reason I didn't push it more than that was because I had no idea that it could actually cause his death. I was just thinking, like, this is, you know, it really sucks that he's in the restraints. This would never happen in New Zealand. It's probably really uncomfortable for him, but he's going to, you know, like, he's not going to kill him. So I wanted to have the doctors on my good side, so I didn't want to be, you know, an aggressive person telling them to take them out of the restraints. That's why I didn't push it further. If I had known, of course, I would have done anything I could have to try to stop.
And then you asked what his experience was in the New Zealand hospital. So he did end up, he started out in the New Zealand hospital voluntarily, and then he was able to go in and out of the ward whenever he wanted to. And then he became paranoid and started to act a little strange. He tried to pull me with him and to go somewhere else, trying to tell me to go to another hospital in another place. And they decided to put him in a evaluation for whether he should be put in compulsory, they call it the Mental Health Act in New Zealand. So he was in a locked ward at that point. And they did put him for one a couple of hours, they put him in a room that was called a low stimulation room that didn't have any, basically it was like the padded wall kind of room where you didn't have any, there was nothing he could hurt or hurt himself with. But it was only a few hours, and they never put any physical restraints on him, and they never needed to. I never saw anybody there with physical restraints. And when I talked to his psychiatrist, when Kelly was still alive, and I talked to his psychiatrist in New Zealand to ask about, you know, we were feeling horrible about these restraints. And I talked to him about it, and he said, yeah, he thought it was pretty horrible too, that they wouldn't do it in New Zealand, that... And he said the reason they don't do it in New Zealand is because it loses, they lose the trust of the patient. That it makes it much harder to actually make them better again because the patient no longer trusts the doctor. And so that's what they told me. But I don't know what, you know, they might use restraints if they have to. No, I think they told me that they usually just use people to restrain, other people to restrain the patients if they need to.
So this person's been waiting at the back.
She's wanted.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
Same thing.
My name is Yoshiko Mia. I'm a freelance journalist covering social security and social welfare, and includes psychiatric treatment. Hasegawa-sensei, konnichiwa.
Konnichiwa.
I'd like to ask Ms. Martha Savage and Mr. Patrick Savage. There are many victims in the similar situation in Japan, but usually they are unknown. On the case of Kelly, fortunately and unfortunately, the victim was a foreigner. On the other way to say, our country and Japanese cannot ignore Kelly because he is not Japanese. I would like to ask the Martha and Patrick, do you have words for ordinary Japanese people to reconsider their sight for people under psychiatric disorder? They are considering in Japanese, 精神病だからどういう扱いも仕方ない、拘束されても仕方がない、死んでも仕方がない。Ordinary Japanese allows such treatment and death for other Japanese. I think no one should not treat it in such way, but they don't think so. Do you have words for Japanese?
This is my feeling about the Japanese people. It seems to me that they are afraid to tell anybody about mental illness. That's a stigma that's really bad in Japan, and families don't want anybody to know that their children had mental illness, and they don't want them to know if they are in the hospital or they're mistreated, because people might find out that they have mental illness. So I may be just projecting that, but that's what I think is a problem. And then if you don't, so I think in America and New Zealand and most of the rest of the world, there are many patient groups and parent advocacy groups to try to help mentally ill patients, and they are effective. So I think Japan needs to make some kind of groups like that. Hasegawa sensei is trying to make a group to help the Japanese people, and I hope that we can be a catalyst to help the Japanese people make their own groups and rise up against mistreatment.
Yeah, and I think that's what Kelly would have wanted. You know, he loved Japan. He was, you know, wasn't super open about his mental health illness, but sometimes he would post on Facebook, you know, he's battling with depression. I think he would want people to know that he had this treatment, and he would want his death not to be in vain, and to help people in Japan not have to suffer the same thing that he suffered.
It was just a top.
ちょっと通訳の方お願いしていいですか。あの日本にも患者グループはあります、全国精神病者集団というあのナショナルグループが一つあり、40年以上活動していますが大きな力に慣れていないんです。私たちの問題だと思います。ありがとうございます。
Okay. Good luck. 頑張ってください。
So, I'm sorry. It was just one final question. Time for just one final question. I already called you on.
Hi. I'm Teddy Jimbo. A member of this club. And sorry, I came in late. So this issue might have been discussed. But if so, please elaborate further. And I'm going to ask this question to in Japanese because this is a question to Mr. Hasegawa. Hasegawa 先生、どうも今日はありがとうございました。ですね、先ほど先生が利権、という話をされた、つまりこの研究をしようとするとそれにが多くの利権に関わると。でその利権も含めてなんですけれども、なぜこの問題がここまで、本当に、スポットが当たらなかったか、あるいは、実際にこれだけ広く精神科医によってこの、プラクティスですね、この、世界の中では異例な、もしかしたら異常な、身体拘束というものがここまでずっと続いてきたのか、その、要因が単に人々がそれから目をそらしていたからなのか、それとも、それも含めて他になぜこれが 今まで続いてきたのか、そして、同時に今ここに来てこれが、先生のご努力も当然終わりになるし皆さん あの努力もあると思いますが、今ここに来てこれがようやく、光が当たったのはなぜなのか、ちょっとそこの説明をもしよろしければお願いします。
そうですね、なぜここまで、こういうことにスポットが当たるのが時間かかったかっていうのは、いろんな要因があるとは思います。でも一つの要因としては医療とか医学というものが非常にその権威主義的だということですね。
はい、
があると思います。
はい、じゃあクエスチョンの方からいきますね。Therefore, his question was with regard to the vested interest he touched upon, Professor Hasegawa touched upon earlier on. Now, was it the root cause behind the lengthy and the historical practice of the physical restraint here in Japan? That was the original question. And answering to his question, he says that here in Japan, in the first place, the medical practice and the medicine itself and the medical society itself is a highly authoritarian. That's the first thing. And that actually induces the vested interest very much.
で、特に精神医療の場合は、その人を人間が人間を、縛るっていうことが、医師の専門性の判断の中に含まれているっていうことが本質的な問題じゃないかなというふうに思っています。
And the very focus and the intrinsic issue of the physical restraint is as follows. Especially in the psychiatric medicine, the physicians, psychiatric physicians are allowed to give an order or instruction to give the or administer the or apply the physical restraint. And it's a part of their practice and it's part of their evaluation or assessment.
それに、病院を今の病院の機能なり病院の数あるいは、患者さんの数そういうものを維持しようっていうふうなパワーが一方にあります。
And also there is a kind of power that is existing in the medical society. The current number of hospitalsand their functions should be maintained. That's a kind of underplaying power.
で、それに、そういうふうなパワーの方にはお金もいっぱいついている。
And as you see, that sort of power is dragging a lot of money around it.
で、そういうものに対抗しうるためには、人権っていうものの考え方が、日本においても確立されていかないと、 身体拘束が減るっていうことがないと思います。
In order to face off that sort of money dragging power, we need to firmly establish the human right concept in the first place here in Japan.
現状だと医療とか医師の権威っていうものが、身体拘束を正当化している。
As a matter of fact, here, today in Japan, the physical restraint is justified under the authority of the medical circle and their medicines in Japan.
だから日本人一人一人が人権というものを真剣に考えて、その人権が守られる社会を実現していくっていう気持ちにならないと、身体拘束が減っていくこともないと思います。
Unless we Japanese, one by one, can think of the human rights to our heart, we would not be able to eliminate every single physical restraint in our society.
日本人からすれば大変残念ながら、日本人がのことじゃなくて、そのサベジさんご一家のこのことで、こういうことが、こういう、まあ、ムーブメントが起こるっていうのは、日本人自身の中から起こせなかったというのは残念なことで言えるかもしれません。
Well, I must say it is regretful that the Kelly's incident actually triggered the movement of us like this. And however, that's the very cause that activated our launch of the alliance.
でも、まあ、人権を守るという共通の価値のために頑張りたいと思っています。
But we'd like to make our every effort in the best, in order to protect the human rights.
以上です。
That's all for me.
I'm sorry to everyone else who had questions, but I'm afraid we've run out of time. Thank you so much to Professor Hasegawa and also to Martha and Patrick Savage for telling us about Kelly's story.And about the changes you're seeking. I also want to thank Ms. Sakai Gloria Kato for the interpretation today. Thank you very much.